to those who carried out this attack, as well as anyone who wishes America harm, know this: we will not forgive. We will not forget. We will hunt you down and make you pay. I will defend our interests and our people with every measure at my command.
Okay, so that was President Joe Biden responding to the devastating set of explosions at the airport in Kabul yesterday. It's the sort of message that we have heard from past presidents in the wake of terror attacks. It has traditionally been the thing that you say as you launch into another interminable conflict. We are hoping that that is not what it is. But he does have to respond forcefully, at least in a rhetorical sense. Because the explosions, it turns out, did kill, some news is saying 12 US service members. I've seen others that say 13, but more than the four we had heard about when we were responding live yesterday on the damage report. 15 others were injured. It is the deadliest attack against US forces in Afghanistan since 2011. The first US military casualties in the country since February of last year. In total, 90 people were killed while 150 others were injured. That is a number of Afghans, including children, those who had been gathered outside of the airport, you know, desperately hoping to be able to get out. Flights have resumed. I just want to let you know about that. Apparently, about 12,500 people were evacuated from Afghanistan in the past 24 hours. So, the capacity of the airport to, you know, get people out was hurt, but not as much as I would have predicted. But that said, we are going to have more from Joe Biden about what happened and what his plans are. Brett, what do you make of it so far?
I mean, there's just so many people with so many horrible, stupid takes on this. Yeah, when they should have more information. Last week, last night on the Young Turks, we showed like Jim Sciutto's reaction, and now it's being echoed. Basically, you have to have your eyes open to a handful of things, like A, what has happened on the lead up to this. You can't take your eye off the ball of like who set up our retreat, who didn't retreat from Afghanistan after, or who didn't pull out of Afghanistan after we accomplished our mission. How little of the mission was ever articulated, not only to the public, but also to people who were there. I know a Navy SEAL who, in the wake of all this, was like, yeah, when I was there, I had no clue what we were doing, and they never explained it to us.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I don't know how you plan on breaking this out, but like if I know Joe Biden seems to have been the one who's like, I am too old for this crap, so I'm getting out now. I wanted to under Obama, and I'm the president of the United States now, so I'm gonna do it. This was never gonna be an easy thing. I don't know of any alternatives that should have been that have sounded better to me when explained. But you know, the most frustrating thing is like, the folks who are criticizing this all are former Pentagon people who are part of the apparatus that failed miserably in appraising the situation from all reports internally in the first place. So now they're going to be Monday morning quarterbacks telling you exactly what you did wrong, even though they were quarterbacks yesterday.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, and we're going to get more to some of those bad takes in a little bit. If anyone has a foolproof system for stopping a person with an explosion or an explosive strapped under their coat from getting into a milling crowd of thousands of people, I'm sure the US military and in fact militaries around the world would love to know what that is. I don't know what that's supposed to be. It's a chaotic, it is a devastating tragedy that is far harder to actually stop from happening than those who are using it cynically, politically, whether to increase the military force in Afghanistan, lengthen its duration, or just score points against the Democrats as we pull out, will ever admit that it actually is. But that said, for a minute, let's focus on the effect of the people that are still there. There are hundreds of thousands estimated to still be trying to escape from the imminent takeover of rule by the Taliban in Afghanistan. Very few of them appear to be getting to the gates, at least as of early today. The crowd numbered in the hundreds rather than the thousands of previous days. And Taliban forces have been keeping them farther away from the airport's entrance gates than previously. still at risk of further attacks, but seem like they're less likely then to get as many people because not as many are there, and US and Taliban security forces, which are gonna be a little bit more distant perhaps. We are also finding out that while the initial flow of people getting out of the country wasn't that much hampered by yesterday's attacks, there is reason to believe that over the next few days, we might run into a major decrease because, and this is reporting on The Intercept, partly by a friend of the show, Ken Klippenstein, says that the Defense Department has asked congressional staff to stop sending evacuation requests on behalf of some Afghans whose work for the US during the war may now put them at risk of Taliban reprisals, according to two people that they spoke to for that. The Defense Department and the House Armed Services Committee did not respond to a request for comment, but the fear is that some of the people who had already been processed were being moved out yesterday, and perhaps more will today. We still have a few more days for the evacuation. Will they continue to process new applicants during that time? This is reason to potentially fear that that might not happen.
Yeah, there's a lot that you have to remember. In Biden's speech, he said, this feels bad. Obviously, we're all aching. He invoked his son who died after being deployed in Iraq. The other thing that he said was we got 100,000 people out so far.
Yeah.
The other thing is Jen points out in the comments, like he said, we have very credible threats that this kind of thing is gonna be happening. Please be advised. There's not really a lot, you know, that's an accurate statement. They were getting active, credible threats. And this is a very difficult thing, and it hurts. And yes, they're gonna have to change the way they're doing this. But odds are, there's a bunch of people that are also hampering the efforts themselves. Like there was another Congress member who was trying to fly into Kabul in a private jet, which doesn't have the same kind of security and safety measures in place as a military grade jet. And they were turned away because it's like, just get out. Unless you're gonna be part of this, get out. But then again, you find yourself in this very strange situation where now you're like weighing who I have to trust in this situation. Like, yeah. Cause I'm going with the people who screwed up what was gonna happen in Afghanistan afterwards. But yeah, I wanna get to the point where you're pointing out all these people who are having these terrible takes.
We will. Right before we get to that though, partially as a result of this and partially fears that we've been echoing for a week and a half now about your questions of what the long-term commitment to refugee resettlement will be from not just our government, but others. But obviously we have, you know, the most potential ability to to raise the number here. Representatives Barbara Lee, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, and more than 60 other House Democrats yesterday urged the Biden administration to raise the US refugee admissions cap to at least 200,000 for fiscal year 2022, saying that as the people of Afghanistan face an unfolding tragedy, the United States must open its doors to refugees fleeing the devastating consequences of a 20-year US military occupation and 40 years of US fueled war. This would be a massive increase in the refugee cap because as of this year, it was set at 62,500. And that was only after progressive pushback from its original 15,000 person limit that had been imposed by the Trump administration. But bear in mind, all of this is kind of nonsense because it's technically 62,500 as of the last time we checked in like a week and a half ago, they'd gotten about 5,000 refugees resettled this year. So hardly on track to meet that cap. So some progressives are, and by the way, you might say, well, how are we gonna reach that in the few days that are remaining? Well, the few days that are remaining are when we have armed forces in the Kabul airport. That does not mean that that is the end for when refugees fleeing Afghanistan could potentially try to resettle in the US. That can continue. We do not have to have 5,000 soldiers there to continue to open up for those who are able to make it to the United States. And that is something that I would like to see more support for.
Yeah.
Okay.
The one thing that bears talking about is all these right wingers are like, I can't believe that Glenn Beck was turned away from trying to get refugees to America. But they're selecting Christian Afghans. They're like, discriminate. We want the Christian ones. We don't want the dirty Muslim ones. We want the Christian ones. That stuff makes me want to puke.
I hadn't even heard about that. It's terrible. I wonder to what extent he's even actually doing it. It's terrible enough if he is that it's so discriminatory, but.
And they're in
many way
out loud.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.